This is Margaret Kerry. I'm the original reference model for Walt Disney for the little character of Tinkerbell. And I'm skywalking through Neverland.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
Ladies, listen!
A billion years in the making.
Welcome to Neverland!
What do you know?
You'll laugh, you'll cry, you'll kiss $3 goodbye.
Hey, everyone. Welcome to episode 15 of Skywalking Through Neverland. We are the podcast that spotlights you, the fan. This is Richard.
And this is Sarah, also known as Jedi Tink.
Today we have a special co-host,
Dave Skale, the Rebel Spy.
Coming up on today's show, I'm very excited because we have an interview with Margaret Kerry.
Now, she was the reference animation model for Tinkerbell. When they were first animating Peter Pan.
I'm so excited because our podcast name has Neverland in it.
We had met Margaret Kerry back at Kamikaze, and Dave, you were there too.
I remember.
And then she pointed at my Skywalking Through Neverland shirt, and she called us over. When Margaret Kerry says, come on over, you come on over.
You listen when Tink talks.
Yeah, exactly. All 4'11" of her. And she starts talking to us like we're the only ones in the room.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, so when am I going to be on your show?
Her voice is just the cutest thing ever. And then she even took a card, one of our cards, and flipped it over and wrote down Margaret Kerry and her phone number. Her actual phone number.
Now,
on
Sarah,
it.
If someone had told you when you were a little girl that you would one day have Tinkerbell's phone number, how would you respond to that?
My mind would have exploded. I don't think I could have handled it.
So later on, we have part one of our interview with Margaret Kerry. Also on today's episode, we have one of Dave Scale's segments, The Rebel Spy.
I hear he's good.
He's very good. You know what? Give us a little short synopsis on The Rebel Spy.
The Rebel Spy is where we explore the ultimate Star Wars Disney mashup, Star Tours. That's that really awesome ride where we get to go into the Star Wars universe at Disney theme parks. Way cool.
Dave did a full, very comprehensive report on The Rebel Spy.
I prefer to call it a thesis.
Oh, yes, because he goes.
Are you getting college credit for this?
Yes, I am.
You did a lot of research, right?
I did.
And today we'll be airing episode one of Dave Scales, The Rebel Spy. It's almost like Precious's push by novel and
the novel by Push.
The Rebel Spy,
Precious.
A novel by Dave Scales, care of Disney theme parks.
Also on today's show, we're starting a brand new segment called
The Disney Classic Short Report.
And basically what that is, we're going to start reviewing the old-time Disney shorts that may have been forgotten over time. The Steamboat Willie era, and even earlier. Remember the Alice comedies or Oswald the Lucky Rabbit?
Nope.
We assembled a team of listeners and friends who are going to be doing these reports for us.
I'm also excited about this segment because I made a really cute graphic for it. So if you guys are watching the podcast, make sure to check it out.
The operative word there is watch the podcast.
Now, last Sunday was the Run Disney Tinkerbell Half Marathon at Disneyland. And I ran that with Monique. And I'm sure if you heard the last podcast, you heard what I wore. Do anybody remember?
C-3PO?
No, I'm not as tall as C-3PO.
Boba Fett?
No, I'd never be
I'll give
Boba
you a
Fett.
Hint. He sounds like this.
Jabba.
No, it was R2. I was running as R2, and actually, Ashley Eckstein at her universe retweeted my tweet of my picture from the race. I was excited.
Oh.
I was like the only one dressed as R2. Everyone else was princesses or fairies, except Monique. Monique was dressed as the evil queen. So whenever I was running past people who were watching, whenever they'd notice me, they'd go, R2, go R2. And that would give me a little extra boost. It really pays to wear kind of a different costume.
Now, were there any other costumes that stood out?
Anybody dressed as Tinkerbell?
There were a ton of Tinkerbell and fairies and people with wings attached to them. It was really cute to watch, and lots of tutus.
every racer has their own corral to start in.
Well, not every racer. We have A, B, C, D, and E corrals. E being the last corral that leaves with all the slower walker runners. And A, of course, being full of lots of runners who are gung-ho and even the runners who are racing to win. So when I got my badge, usually I'm in C corral, kind of middle of the road. But I got my badge and it said I was in A corral, which was pretty awesome.
You weren't expecting that.
No, I wasn't. I wasn't. But I think the Tinkerbell Half Marathon has a lot less runners than like the Disneyland Half Marathon, say. So I was further ahead just because of that, because there were less people to compete with.
Just once, I'd like to see Margaret Kerry run the Tinkerbell Marathon. I think that would be really cool. I wonder what corral she would be in.
Well, she's 84 going on 85, so I'm going to guess she'd be in corral B.
B, yeah. Yeah, that'd be my guess too. And being the original Tink, people would get out of her way.
Well, she was actually there at the expo.
How did you place in this race?
I placed 4,974th out of 13,144 people.
Once again, it's not a race you do for time.
Yeah.
It's a race you do for fun. These all these characters you can take pictures with.
Yeah, my actual clock time, my overall time was 2 hours and 42 minutes. But on my Nike, I really ran it probably in 2 hours and 30 minutes, 2 hours, 25 minutes.
I use taking pictures as my excuse to stop whenever I go running, too. It's hard when I'm on a treadmill, but hey, it works for me.
Yeah, yeah. It gives a nice break to the legs.
So then now we have another, what, 5 more weeks until your next race?
Yep. The Princess Half Marathon.
That's when the Skywalking Through Neverland team here goes cross-country.
To Disney World.
Yes.
Now for this next marathon, it's going to be you and I running.
Yes.
And Dave, you're going to be doing...
Sleeping.
We're kind of hoping you'd run alongside us and do some interviews with other racers. By interview, I mean slow them down.
Oh, I can do that, but I'm probably going to be sleeping, so it'll have to be at the finish line.
Is that 6 a.m.? You're going to be in bed?
I'm pretty sure that time doesn't exist.
Richard, we're going to be getting up at like 2:30 a.m. I'm just warning you.
Oh, I'm going to be shushing you guys a lot. I'm going to be like, seriously, guys, seriously, there are people sleeping here, people not running, people on vacation, people still on California time.
Yeah. Oh.
So then if we don't get the story, we know who to look at.
That's fine. I'll be sleeping through it.
Be our guest. Be our guest. Put our service to the test. Buy or not, and we'll provide the rest.
This week on Mousetroid Mixer, we have part one of Margaret Kerry's interview. I am so excited.
I wonder if Captain Hook's listening.
So join us as we take Margaret Kerry skywalking through Neverland.
We are here at KKLA in Glendale, California, talking to the animation reference model of Tinkerbell, Miss Margaret Kerry.
You got that right.
Mouthful.
Well, you know how many people, Richard, take a look and their eyebrows go up when you say, this is Tinkerbell, but you put all the right words in it, the animator's reference model. So I'm so happy to be here with you and Sarah.
Thank you very much for being here on Skywalking Through Neverland. In fact, our name comes from your alter ego's birthplace, Neverland.
Isn't it marvelous? What do you think about when you first heard about a place called Neverland? What did you think?
As a child, I always thought of it as never-ending possibilities. Hmm. Because Peter Pan was a little boy who never grew up. I just had it in my mind, it's a place where there was never a never.
How about you, Sarah?
Well, I kind of grew up with... the Peter Pan and all the movies. Mm-hmm. So immediately in my mind, I see that island of
Right.
So that's
and
that's...
you know, if you really look at that island, there's a lot of evil on that mm-hmm. island, and
pirates.
people forget the pirates and the Skull Island or Skull whatever it is, but when you look at the overhead shot of it. I said to Mark Davis the first time I saw it, it wasn't colored in the first time that it was getting there. I said, that's scary. And he said, really? And I said, yes. He says, that's good. Okay.
Now, who was Mark Davis?
Mark Davis is the man who designed Tinkerbell. And he was my director, and the sweetest man. Just an absolutely fabulous man.
So let's go back a couple of years from there. How did you get started in show business?
Well, I was born in 1929, and I caused the Depression. Yeah, I was born, and everything went right downhill from there.
Oh.
And nobody had a job. I was adopted by two people who were old enough to be my grandparents, sweet people. But my mother had a hankering to be a Hollywood mother. And this was one of the ways that...
Were you here, living here
yes,
in L.A.? Okay.
Yes. My mother couldn't go out and make money because women didn't do that. And my dad was struggling along as a salesman and a broker for some people. So she thought, I'll put this cute little thing in film. Well, fooey, I could make $8.50 a day.
Wow.
And there were some laborers that were lucky to make $2 a day. So it tells you. So in the meantime, there was a fellow named Willie Covan. So I had one of the best teachers, and I was put to work, which wasn't a bad thing. But I had nothing to really compare it to. And every time before I would leave, Willie Covan would always say, yeah, Mr. Rob, that was my new dad's name, Peggy is a dancing fool. Mm. And I knew with that big smile on his face that was good. So I went on in show business, and I did 37 major motion pictures. Uh-huh. I was in our gangs, I think 6 of them. Leonard Maltin and I can't agree. Anyway, I just kept going, but I found television. Mm. And television to me was fabulous. I really didn't like motion pictures. I really didn't, because it is so slow. Well, I found television here at KTLA. It was W6XAO. And W6XYZ, experimental television. And I went on that, and I just fell in love with it. I did the Charlie Ruggles show for 5 years. It was one of the first network shows for the Almost Broadcast, ABC. We called it the Almost Broadcasting Company. Then I had my own show on Channel 13 for 5 years, called Teleteen Reporter, same 5 years. And then I was doing radio. And then I did special things for people like Arch Obler, the author. And from there, I worked with Tommy Noonan and Peter Marshall on a show called Let There Be Stars, which didn't sell. Hmm. It was too grandiose, I think, at that moment. And the choreographer took me over to Fox to be one of his assistants. So I got the call at Fox Studio that they were interviewing for and casting for the reference model for this little 3.5-inch sprite. Could I get the day off tomorrow?
How old were you at this time?
I was 18. Isn't that interesting? Men usually say, what year was it? And women usually say, how old were you?
Yeah, men know better.
Yeah, I guess so.
No, it is very interesting through the years. Anyway, I got the time off. And the night before, I choreographed a pantomime, because I knew this little character was a pantomime character. And I danced to a 3-minute 45 record, the ones with the big holes in the middle. And I took the player and the 45 with me, and I went over to Disney Studios, which was a dream of almost anybody who worked in the movie business. I mean, it was just, you just knew it was magical.
You said you got a call from Fox to do this?
From my agent.
Gotcha.
From my agent when I was at Fox.
Now, I have a question for you. When how much of Tinkerbell's attitude came from you, or was it written in the script that you're supposed to be kind of sassy?
Well, I had read the James M. Barry book. And by the way, Sarah, if you don't mind, I'm going to tell people to go to Barnes & Noble and get the unabridged James M. Barrie book. You will learn more about all the characters that you love in Peter Pan than me talking or seeing the movies, all six of them that are out there now. And so I sort of knew what I was going to do with her. It had been a while since, but I remembered her as about 11 years old. And she was just enchanted with life. She was enchanted with everything that she saw that was new. And no one was going to cut down that those vibrations in her. She was going over and look. She was going to see what it was made of. If she had to take it apart, she'd take it apart. So that's the way that I played her. And I think I've done this a lot when I do speeches. By the way, if there's anybody out there who has an organization who wants a speaker, all they have to do is call Tinkerbell or get to TinkerbellTalks.com and send an email through that. Let's see. I do a lot of talking. I go to hospitals, children's hospitals. So back to what I was saying. What was I saying?
About Tinkerbell and
attitude.
Her attitude.
So the first thing that they asked me to do was to do a pantomime of dropping down on the big looking glass or the mirror that was on Wendy's dresser and see herself in the reflection and then take a look at herself and be pleased and then be unhappy at the size of her hips. Yes. And so I said, sure. So that's what I did. But I must say, if any of you are watching Peter Pan, and you'd better be, because I'll check up on you. Anyway, you will notice that she is not preening. I played her as if she was seeing herself for the first time. I figured, why would they have a mirror in Neverland? So that's what she's doing. And she's almost saying out loud, oh, I'm cute. Oh, look at those wings. Oh, isn't that? Oh my. And then get upset about her hips being too large as far as she's concerned.
She really is a girl.
So when we actually got on the soundstage, and I had my hair done up by the hairdresser before I came, didn't have to wear any makeup, and came over to the set. And it was a set. They had props and things there. The first time that I stepped out in front, I said something like, Mr. Davis, do you want her to be ditzy like Betty Boo? Or do you want her to be like the Queen of the Fairies? And he said, Margaret, we want her to be you.
Aww.
And I said, golly gee, I think I can do that. And that is my personality. They had the two dimensions, the line drawing, the width and the height, and I gave the third dimension. And that's the way I try to explain it.
Were you shown a script to Peter Pan, or did they just direct you through scenes?
They showed me the storyboard.
Okay.
A storyboard with larger than thumbnail sketches and the dialogue underneath so that I could react.
Were you familiar with the character of Tinkerbell before you had the role?
Only through reading the book. I had a wonderful schooling at Monticello School for Girls, where I went to school with Diane and Sharon Disney.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Did you? Reading was always so important, and I went to a school where they trained you to read in phrases.
Oh,
they
yeah.
never allowed you to read one word at a time, which really came in handy because I became an actress.
Mm-hmm.
And cold reading, I mean, that's the key to it. So, yes, I knew about her there, and there was no, I know this sounds really awful, guys, but there was no internet.
What?
I know.
How did you get in touch with your friends?
I know.
Where did you Facebook?
I didn't, as a matter of fact. But anyway, so I knew about her. And then I have to tell you, all of the big pieces of paper with the sketches on them of Tinkerbell gave you the rhythm. So that's how I played her.
Tinkerbell is my favorite Disney character, but I didn't know it until I went to the Beast Library at Disney California Adventure and took that personality quiz to see which character I was most like, and I got Tinkerbell. And from that moment on, I was like, oh, I love Tinkerbell.
And did you agree?
Yes.
All right. Well, all I can say is you always like Tinkerbell, and you have good taste.
Yes.
I just thought I would. And you, Richard, do you like Tinkerbell?
I love Tinkerbell.
Well, then there's the two of you have good taste. I think she's beguiling. She warms your heart when she's very bad. She warms your heart when she's very good. You can't take your eyes off of her. You want to know what she's doing. You want to follow her because she beguiles you with this joy. And she's childlike. Sometimes she's childish, but she's also childlike. Mm-hmm. And so I call her beguiling. So you may use it if you like.
Yeah.
Yeah, the first word that popped in my mind was protective. She's very protective of Peter Pan. Everything she does in the beginning is all because she wants to protect her friend, her, I think, love interest, quote unquote, from anything in this world known as Earth.
Now, may I take that a step further?
Sure.
Protective is certainly in her because she saves his life.
Right.
Right. But she's also protective of Tinkerbell. Well, you know, I was also the redheaded mermaid. Yes. In Peter Pan, and I was the reference model for her, along with June Foray.
Oh, really?
as the dark-haired, and Connie Hilton was the blonde, and we had lines, and one of the lines that I did in as the redhead mermaid was, "We just wanted to drown her." And that got me on the way to doing voiceovers. And I thought, this is the way to do it, because you get to the studio or the recording studio in the afternoon because your voice is stronger. They give you a script. You don't have to learn anything. You don't have to have makeup on. You don't have to have your hair done. You don't have to wear a costume. If they don't like the character that you're doing, they say, okay, let's try another one, and you read it again, and you're out of there in 2 hours. I mean, think about that for a minute. So that's why I went into doing over 600 cartoons, voiceovers.
When you first saw Tinkerbell, did you hear a voice that she may have?
No, I didn't. I heard a tinkling of a bell. And a tinkling of a bell, I think, maybe I could be wrong about this, but when I think about it right now, your question, I think it made me feel lighter. You know, so I was a ballet dancer and a tap dancer and a darn good one. And my walk, if you look at when you watch Peter Pan the next time, and you watch Tinkerbell's walk, it is the walk of a ballerina. And so when I was doing her, I was up half toe or very flat foot and then lift up as ballet dancers do. So I think it was all the lifting. Now, I can't be sure that that was it, but no, I never heard a voice.
Interesting.
Good question.
Oh, thank you very much. You had told a really interesting story that I've always wondered about. What? Why Tinkerbell is on all the Disney park merchandise. Oh.
Well, here's the story. Walt Disney, his motto was give people more than they expected. And so when he started looking into this, what he called a theme park, and everybody else thought, are you out of your mind? He was putting his own money up for this. The WED, it was called Walter E. Disney Production. And looked around, and then he had really intelligent, wonderful people who were working with him. He says, you've got to get bigger than this. You've got to do this. And this is what you can do for people. And then he was going to Anaheim, for heaven's sakes. And well, over at the studio, they didn't really know what was going on, and they were scared. So they asked Roy if he would talk to Walt and say, please don't use any of our major characters. Huh? They were worried that if the park, whatever it was, went bankrupt, it would take the luster away from the main characters. Well, can you imagine? Here's Walt Disney, and he's got his theme park started, his Mickey's Village, and no Mickey, no Minnie, no anything. So a couple of days later, he said, you tell the ones who are worrying that I'm bringing back Tinkerbell and Jiminy Cricket. So in the meantime, and concomitantly, isn't that a great word? I learned that last week. At the same time, there we go. They were running out of money. They decided that they would go over to ABC television. They had a start of a TV show. I really am not quite sure. But they said, would you like to come on aboard ABC? And ABC said, yes, if we can have 1 hour Disney show on Sunday. Well, Walt Disney, and I thought this was the smartest move he ever made, decided that Tinkerbell should come into his office each time. And there would be some chit-chat and some rolling of the eyes with Tinkerbell and all the rest. And then she was the one who would take people on the adventure. Then when the park opened, it was perfectly okay with him that Tinkerbell was on every napkin, every banner, every, you name it, she was there. It didn't happen that much with Jiminy Cricket, and you know why?
Why?
Because I was much cuter than Jiminy Cricket.
Absolutely, I would agree with that.
So I think that that's what, and of course, the rest is history, because he gave them more than they could ever expect.
Mm-hmm. Yes, he did.
And I have a friend of mine whose father was spirited away from his office downtown Los Angeles to go over and meet Walt Disney. And this man, Mr. Zoll, walked in and he's saying, okay, where is this guy I'm supposed to meet? And Walt Disney turns around and says, hello, I'm Walt Disney. And Mr. Zoll said, how do you do? You know, why am I here? Did not know who he was. Mm. And so Walt Disney had the chili that you've heard about, all cooked. And they sat down and had chili. And after they finished, Walt Disney says, I'm told you're the man that I want to put all the lighting into Disneyland. Come over this way. And he showed him, Mr. Zoll, the maps of Disneyland. And Mr. Zoll said, this was the most incredible person. If a shop needed, as far as Mr. Zoll was concerned, some, and he had a big company, it needed a special chandelier. Walt Disney says, sketch it for me, and I'll keep. Nice. He said it was only the best. Everything was the best. And that was one of the things that slowed him down in getting it. So, you know, I have those little tidbits and those little asides that are just so dear to me.
So join us next week for Margaret Kerry Interview Part 2. Now, the original interview of Margaret Kerry was an hour and a half. And next week,
there was a lot of great stuff in there, too.
Yeah. I mean, she knew Walt Disney. She's met him.
She's looked Walt in the eye.
Yeah. And the complete unedited version will be on our website, skywalkingthroughneverland.com, next week. So look for that bonus content.
So once again, we want to thank everyone for listening to Skywalking Through Neverland.
So if you have any comments, suggestions, things that we can be doing better, we would really love to hear from you. So let us know by sending us an email off of our website, Skywalking Through Neverland. And if there are things that you think are great and wonderful, please let us know by going to iTunes and posting a 5-star review.
It'd be much appreciated. Now, as many of you know, we do two different versions of our podcast. One is the audio only, and one is the video. If you are one of the ones watching the video on YouTube or at skywalkingthroughneverland.com, enjoy this next 45 seconds of The Adventures of Clark and Snips, Our Bunny Rabbits.
Yay! Oh.
If you are not watching the video podcast, enjoy the next 45 seconds to the theme to The Avengers. So now it's time for Dave Scales, the Rebel Spy.
This is really cool.
So now what you did is you went and broke down Star Tours from the inception all the way to Star Tours 2, The Adventure Continues.
Now, I went back even further than that. I went to pre-Star Tours, the ride Adventures Through Inner Space, which was the ride that was there before Star Tours, because that's really where all the adventure begins.
How interesting. And so you like researched all these Easter eggs, right?
All the Easter eggs, all the backstories, all the work that went into bringing that ride to life.
Nice.
Now let's bring you part one of Dave Scales,
The Rebel Spy. And you guys will find out what that means at the end of all these segments. If you've never ridden the ride, you're like, why is he calling it The Rebel Spy? Well, you're going to have to wait and see.
Dave, you've been The Rebel Spy.
I am The Rebel Spy.
And Sarah, you've been The Rebel Spy.
Yippers.
You've been The Rebel Spy, Richard.
Let's just roll the package.
Hi, this is Dave Scale, and welcome to the first edition of a new segment called The Rebel Spy, where we talk about some of the most amazing Star Wars and Disney mashups ever. And today, we are going to be talking about the ultimate Star Wars and Disney mashup, Star Tours. So let's get right into it. What is Star Tours? Star Tours is a virtual reality Disney ride that takes you into the Star Wars universe. It's this incredible flight simulator that creates a Star Wars adventure as you fly through space. And once inside, the simulator moves in conjunction with the images on the view screen to simulate an actual space flight. And of course, unexpected things go wrong, and that's where the adventure begins to get fun. But before we get into all the details about Star Tours, let's go a little bit back in time to the time before Star Tours. People like me who grew up in Southern California can remember that there was actually a ride called Adventures Through Inner Space, or as we locals called it, Monsanto. And we called it Monsanto because it was Adventures Through Inner Space sponsored by the Monsanto Chemical Company. And we were kids, and for some reason, we just thought Monsanto was the name of the ride. So anyways, in the Adventures Through Inner Space ride, you started off in a carriage, kind of like the carriage you get into at the Haunted Mansion. And your carriage approaches this giant shrink ray that was called the Mighty Microscope. And you are reduced smaller and smaller until you actually enter a molecule and eventually an atom. Well then, according to Wikipedia, in 1979, Disney began developing an interactive ride simulator based on their then-released film, The Black Hole. But the plan was shelved due to its approximate $50 million price tag and the fact that nobody liked the movie The Black Hole. Meanwhile, Disney and George Lucas teamed up in the mid-80s and, in 1986, opened Captain EO, a 3D interactive musical film that starred Michael Jackson at Disneyland. Around that time, Disney Imagineers approached George Lucas with the flight simulator idea for Star Tours. And Michael Eisner was looking to renovate Disneyland, which had been losing a lot of the younger demographic to other local theme parks. So he invited George Lucas to visit the Imagineering department, and when Lucas saw the plans for an outer space flight simulator, he agreed to work on the project. Disney reportedly agreed to give Lucas a percentage of the merchandise fees as well as a $6 million fee to create the film for the ride. And at a press conference, Lucas reportedly said that if he was going to work on a theme park attraction, he wanted it to be Disney. With Lucas on board, Disney purchased four military-grade flight simulators at a cost of $500,000 each and went to work designing the actual ride. In the meantime, Lucas and his team at Industrial Light & Magic had been designing the first-person film of the adventure that would be projected inside of the ride. So, during the construction, four 40-person simulators were dropped in through the roof of the building before they were enclosed. But the attraction soon ran into several delays. The first problem was that they couldn't get the motion simulator to synchronize with the film properly. Then, they reportedly realized that the roof of the building would need to be raised, which meant that the entire structure of the building would have to be rebuilt. And then Lucas rejected the audio system in the ride, which added another $100,000 to meet his standards. But finally, they got those bugs worked out. And once the film and the simulator were completed, a programmer sat inside and used a joystick to synchronize the movements of the simulator with the images on the screen. So, on January 9th, 1987, Star Tours was finally open. The final cost was $32 million, which was the same budget as the entire film of Return of the Jedi, and almost twice the cost of building the entire park in 1955.
And here's a little trivia. Star Tours was the first Disney attraction that is based on a non-Disney produced film. As you can imagine, Star Tours was extremely popular, and Disney decided to add the attraction to Disney World's MGM Studios over in Florida. So, now that the ride was officially launched, here is some debate as to exactly when the storyline of the ride was set. Star Tours Adventure may take place after Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back, and in 2005, Lucasfilm's Leland Chi tentatively dated the events of the ride at 4.3 ABY after the Battle of Yavin. So that concludes our first episode of The Rebel Spy. Join us next time where we begin our adventure and experience the original version of the ride Star Tours.
We are not only debuting one new segment this podcast, we're debuting Disney Classic Short Report.
The Disney Channel has been airing brand new animated Disney shorts on a new series called Mickey Mouse. These shorts feature the more well-known characters such as Mickey, Minnie, Donald, Goofy, and Pluto. And many of you who watch the Disney Channel may have seen some of these shorts. But do you remember the old-time shorts? We're like going back to 1920s, 1930s.
I remember them well, except I wasn't born yet.
The most well-known Disney short being...
Oh, Steamboat Willie.
Steamboat Willie. Mm-hmm. But, all right, show of hands. How many of you people out there know the Alice comedies? Nope. How about Oswald the Lucky Rabbit?
I know of that simply because of Disney California Adventure Park.
Do we have any love for the Laugh-O-Grams?
No. Never.
See, most people don't know what these are. Now, when Sarah and I were doing the Disney scavenger hunt with our friend Chris Alexander, we were in the Main Street Cinema, which has six screens. And every one of these screens has another Disney short. Some of these shorts I've never seen before, but they were so interesting and unique. And you could tell they had a real good stamp on their time frame from when they were made. So we thought, let's reintroduce people to these shorts. We don't want these forgotten films to go unforgotten. So we put together a Skywalking Through Neverland review team and asked each one to take one film and give us their synopsis and review and remind us why these films are such classics.
So our first reviewer is Teresa Delgado, and she is taking on one of the many Oswald the Lucky Rabbit shorts.
This is Teresa Delgado, Disney Shorts reporter for Skywalking Through Neverland. On this report, I will be discussing the first Oswald the Lucky Rabbit short called Trolley Troubles that first appeared in 1927. This was actually the first appearance of Oswald the Lucky Rabbit, but it was not his actual first cartoon that was made by Ub Iwerks and Walt Disney. The first cartoon that was actually developed was a short called Poor Papa, but that one, Universal thought that it wasn't Charlie Chaplin enough and that Oswald the Lucky Rabbit was actually too fat and too old, so they rejected it. And the next one that they made was called Trolley Troubles. And in this particular story of this short, Oswald is preparing a trolley to transport his bunny kids and other animal characters, but he runs into a lot of obstacles. When I was watching this particular short, I had a hard time figuring out if his bunny kids were bunnies or if they were cats or if they were dogs. So it was kind of interesting. I didn't figure that out until the end. And one of the main obstacles in the short is actually a cow that walks onto the tracks, and it's a female cow. And when I saw it, I immediately thought, I wonder if this is where Clarabelle Cow came from. But they end up getting past her, and as Oswald tends to think that everything is going well, he gets to a hill that he can't go up. So he has to find some help to get up the hill, and he runs into a goat that actually helps him go up and over the hill. But he continues to run into more trouble as he goes through the entire film, such as a bumpy road that tosses all of the bunny kids out of the trolley as he's moving along, and eventually there's only like one bunny kid left. And as he gets to the end, he's just praying that he's going to live, but then he notices that the trolley track actually ends and there's a big giant cliff, and he crashes off of the cliff and lands in a big giant lake or river. You can't really tell from the short, but the trolley turns into a raft and he uses a stick that he finds in the water to paddle it downstream, and that's essentially the basis of the story. Now, I hadn't actually ever seen an Oswald the Lucky Rabbit short. I, of course, know who Oswald the Lucky Rabbit is, and we see all of his merchandise in the parks and things like that, but I have never actually seen a short. So this was the first time seeing him, and I noticed a lot of very Mickey Mouse things about him, such as some of his mannerisms and the way that he reacts to things when trouble hits. So that was kind of neat. Also, there was the Clarabelle cow thing that I noticed. And I also noticed how I didn't pick up on the Charlie Chaplin thing, but that's probably because of my age. But it definitely was funny, and I did catch myself laughing several times. So I think it was a very well done short. Now, the reason that I picked this one was because I thought, where better to start than at the very beginning of the first shorts that Disney ever actually animated? So. Okay, so just to give some background on Oswald the Lucky Rabbit, he was originally created by Walt Disney and UB Iwerks, and it was at the end of their time of working on their Alice comedy series, and they decided they needed to have a character that was more likable and more had more personality. So a lot of things had been done out in the animated world that were cats, like Felix the Cat and Crazy Cat at the time, so they chose to do a rabbit, and they actually partnered with Universal, but they lost control of Oswald due to fine print in their contract. So this guy by the last name of Mintz actually is the reason that they lost their ownership of Oswald. And so once they lost ownership of Oswald is actually when Mickey Mouse came through, because Walt Disney needed to create a new character since he'd lost his first one. And actually, the loss of Oswald the Lucky Rabbit was incredibly devastating to Walt Disney, and it kind of shaped his life going forward of never allowing anybody to have the rights to any of his characters, to his merchandise, to anything that ever came out in the future. So that's kind of where we see maybe the beginnings of the Disney giant conglomeration of stuff that covers, you know, any book they put out, any toy they put out, any movie they put out, is they control the rights to it, the distribution rights, and all that kind of stuff. So Oswald did continue to have a career once he left Disney, and he went under the direct control of Universal, and they ended up producing about 142 Oswald cartoons. When he left being under the control of Disney, I think they only had, I want to say, somewhere around maybe 20 or so actual released episodes of Oswald the Lucky Rabbit. So you can see that Universal kind of took him and ran with him. Now, Disney did get the rights back to Oswald the Lucky Rabbit, and that's the reason that we see a lot of his merchandise in the park, and we see Oswald ears and things like that. In February of 2006, Bob Iger initiated a trade with NBC Universal that included a bunch of minor assets and other things, but it included the rights to Oswald. And so they were required by the Walt Disney Company, and in exchange for that, they sent Al Michaels from Disney's ABC and NBC to NBC Sports. So Al Michaels could probably say that he was officially traded for a cartoon rabbit. I don't know how he feels about that. But like I said, Disney returned to owning Oswald the Lucky Rabbit in 2006. And since then, he has been in video games like Epic Mickey and Epic Mickey 2 and lots of merchandise. But we haven't seen him back in a cartoon yet. So that'll be interesting if they ever decide to put him back in a cartoon. Now, some of the places that we've seen him in theme parks, in 2010 in Tokyo Disneyland, they produced a float featuring Oswald for their first Easter holiday event. I would have loved to have seen that. In 2011, he appeared with other old Disney characters on construction walls for Disney's California Adventure Park, which I'm sure Richard and Sarah probably saw. In 2011, he appeared on a poster as the Magician's Rabbit in the Town Square Theater at Magic Kingdom Park in Walt Disney World. And in 2012, Disney California Adventure Park at the Disneyland Resort reopened with a new entry land called Buena Vista Street, which was themed to the 1920s Los Angeles. And there's an Oswald service station right as you walk in the door. It's a gift shop, and it sells a whole lot of Oswald merchandise. And actually, in 2013, during the limited time magic stuff, they had some pretty cool Oswald the Lucky Rabbit specific things that were only to Disneyland that I was very jealous of since I didn't get a chance to see it. So that's about it. Now back to Richard and Sarah.
Tune in each fortnight to the IndieCast, the world's number one Indiana Jones fan podcast.
Trust me.
Featuring the latest news, reviews, and interviews with on-screen and behind-the-scenes talent who helped bring to life the greatest adventure movie series ever made. Each episode has the latest from the world of Indiana Jones, as well as interactive segments, trivia, contests, and specials, including radio dramas and music retrospectives. The IndieCast.
It's a transmitter. It's a radio for speaking to God.
Available in iTunes or listen directly at theindiecast.com.
If adventure has a name, it must be the IndieCast.
Prepare to make the jump to light speed.
It's Disneyland Fun Facts, another new segment on Skywalking Through Neverland.
Now, Dave, are you like me and love a fun fact?
You know, I live for fun facts.
Now, in a book called Little Known Facts About Well-Known Places, Disneyland, by David Hoffman, he's got a treasure trove of what?
Fun facts.
Exactly. Such as, when Disneyland opened its gates at 2:30 in the afternoon on July 17th, 1955, it had just 18 rides and attractions.
Only 18?
Only 18. Today, it has 65.
Wow, really?
But back then, it had 18.
Now, and most of, like, Fantasyland was there, correct?
Right. Now, can you two guess, without looking at the list, what rides were there on opening day?
Well, the carousel.
King Arthur's carousel.
Star Tours?
No, that wasn't until 57.
55? I know, not Pirates of the Caribbean. I know the rides that weren't there because I know they were in the 60s.
Okay, Jungle Cruise.
That was one of them. Oh, that's right.
Yeah. The Canal Boats of the World, which later became the Storybook Land Canals. Anything else?
Canal Boats.
I'm still not sure about Star Tours.
Dumbo. Dumbo's Flying Elephants.
Dumbo was another one.
I'm sure there's Snow White's Scary Adventures.
Yes, exactly, right.
Mr. Toad's Wild Ride. Peter Pan's Flight. Okay. What are the other
Star Tours
rides right there?
Dave, you're very close. Monsanto Hall of Chemistry.
What?
And on opening day, how much do you think admission was to Disneyland Park?
Oh, I assume that you're talking about people who actually paid rather than people who try to maybe jump the fence.
And that didn't end too well for most of them.
I'm going to say
$1955.
$1955. I mean, it's like $3.72.
Ooh, subtract $2.72.
I went to public school, so I'm going to say Star Tours.
$1.
Whoa.
$1 versus $1. Today, I think it's $97.
Yeah, and if you want to go park to park, it's like $120.
We have an annual pass, so I don't keep track of what it costs.
Yeah, me either.
It'd make me really sad.
We just know that the annual passes keep going up, but...
Another fun fact from David Hoffman. Opening day of Disneyland was referred to as Black Sunday. Temperatures were unseasonably hot, well over 100 degrees.
Ugh.
In Anaheim, where there's not really a beach anywhere around to get a good sea breeze, that's some hot weather.
Mm-hmm.
I heard that the Hoth scene in Star Tours melted.
Yeah.
And the drinking fountains, they didn't work because there was a plumber strike. So there were no drinking fountains working anywhere. They had the drinking fountains, but they didn't work.
But I had read that they actually had, Disney had to choose between drinking fountains or bathrooms. And he said, well, you know, we need bathrooms. So yeah. That's
right.
Why.
But then guess what happened? The toilets clogged.
Oh.
And having no plumbers on hand, it was not a good day.
Yeah, that's a little awkward.
It was not a good day.
And then, I also heard that the food ran out.
That's their main source of income, the food. Because they can jack that up by 1,000,000%. And then the tar was so soft that the women's high heels kept sinking in to the tar. So it was like moving in a swamp.
Yeah.
But Mr. Disney, I'm sorry, Uncle Walt, was so kind and generous that he would give out moccasins to all the women who had high heel shoes on. That was the only adult shoe they sold was the moccasin. So moccasins for everybody. Now, moving down the list, in addition to the likes of Tomorrowland and Fantasyland and Adventureland, do you know what other land Walt was planning?
I'm really thinking. There was a...
You're never going to get it. He was also planning the Land of Oz.
Wait, don't tell me. I'm still thinking.
He owned the rights to the L. Frank Baum collection. So he had the rights to do The Wizard of Oz.
Oh, that's random.
Yeah, it's very random.
Huh.
Don't know why he never did it. Now, this is another fun fact that Margaret Kerry had brought up in her interview, that in the planning stages, Tom Sawyer Island was originally called Mickey Mouse Island. Now, Walt changed his mind to ensure, should the park go belly up, that Mickey Mouse would not be associated with the failure. This was also the reasoning behind the decision to have Tinkerbell, not Mickey, introduce the Disneyland TV series every week.
And as Margaret Kerry said, that was the best decision Walt ever made.
Once again, man was thinking.
Oh, it's kind of ironic if you think about it. So Tinkerbell was like Disneyland's canary in the coal mine, so that if it went belly up, you know, Tinkerbell's the sacrificial lamb. It's like, we got to save Mickey. Sorry, Tink.
Don't ever bring that up to Margaret Kerry.
No.
Yeah.
She's very mad at you.
I'm just calling it as I see it.
Now, another fun fact, speaking of Tinkerbell, Disneyland's original flying Tinkerbell was 4'10". I think Margaret Kerry's only like 4'11". Maybe that's why she didn't get the job of the flying Tinkerbell.
What was her name?
The flying Tinkerbell's name was Tiny Klein.
Isn't that ironic? So her parents named her Tiny without really, like, you know, we really hope she grows into this name.
Yeah, she was a circus performer and an aerialist who was 71 years old when she first flew down the zip line from the top of the Matterhorn to start the Fantasy in the Sky fireworks show.
Wow.
At 71.
All right, so let me get this straight. So somebody in human resources is saying, we need somebody to go down the zip line.
What do we got? Yeah. Get the 16-year-old,
well,
the 24-year-old.
Who's that just kind of crouched over there,
you know what? That's
their
Tiny
walker?
Klein. She's 71 years old, okay?
How does that happen? You couldn't find anybody that's not 71? Her resume says circus performer, and at the very bottom, it's like circa 1892. It's great because she probably lived long enough to make it to the end of the zip line.
Oh.
Oh.
You know, Too soon?
Before we go down to another dark path, let's move on to our last fun fact of today's segment. Now, a lot of famous people have worked at Disneyland. Do you know of any?
Famous people that worked at Disneyland?
Dude, Steve worked, Martin. What?
Wait, give me a... Don't tell me. Let me figure it out.
Who worked in the magic shop making animal balloons?
Steve Martin.
Don't tell me. Don't tell me. Give me a hint.
Born in Babylon, moved to Arizona.
King Tut worked at
King
Disneyland?
King Tut worked at Disneyland.
You know, I always knew that. I learned about that in school.
For those of you who don't know that song I was just trying to sing, it was Steve Martin who got his start in the
magic
shop.
I'm going to go with Steve Martin.
Now, who would you think would have played Alice in Wonderland in the Main Street Electrical Light Parade? An actress?
Actually, given Disney's track record, they'd say, hey, who's that 70-year-old over there?
All right, I'm going to give you another hint. She wasn't 71, but she did play Catwoman.
Julie Newmar?
Keep guessing.
Michelle Pfeiffer.
Michelle Pfeiffer played Alice in Wonderland in the Main Street Electrical Light Parade.
A few you know more what? Years, she'll be playing Tinkerbell.
You know what? She also starred in Grease 2.
Oh. This was good. This was fun. Why go there? Oh, my goodness.
Oh, that was so funny, that movie. Well, let's see. Who else was famous? You know what? I remember someone played Tarzan. Dirty Dancing.
Patrick Swayze
played Tarzan.
That's right. And another of the Disney parades.
Yes.
Yeah, another actress who just starred as Thor's mom in the Thor movies. Renee Russo.
What was she?
Doesn't say in the book here what she played.
Oh.
But she worked there, so leave it at that.
Maybe she didn't play anybody. Maybe she just was actually a worker.
Maybe she was serving the big turkey legs.
Can you imagine that?
And now, hold on to something. You're not going to believe this. Press secretary to Richard Nixon, Ron Ziegler.
You know, I always wondered if Ron Ziegler wasn't...
I know. That's why I said sit down, because Dave Ron Ziegler, he was the press secretary
of Richard Nixon.
Well, he was a skipper on the Jungle Cruise.
Oh.
That man can tell a joke.
So, you know, there's always been an interesting tie in between Watergate and Disneyland. And this is the bridge that makes all sense.
Now, in the Jungle Cruise, one of the sights they show you is the backside of water. Put it together.
The backside of Watergate. Oh, it all makes sense.
There you go. So who was behind all of this?
So
wasn't Richard Nixon?
No, Richard Nixon might be Walt Disney.
Wait a minute. Walt, I've never seen Walt Disney and Richard Nixon in the same room together.
It all makes sense. It all makes sense.
Once again, a Disney fun fact.
No, once again, you heard it here first. It's Skywalking Through Neverland.
Do you know who else was a Jungle Cruise skipper?
Gilligan?
No, he actually still works for Disney. But he's much higher up now.
Roy? Michael Eisner?
John Lasseter.
John Lasseter?
He's still working as a Jungle Cruise side job?
He was a Jungle Cruise skipper back like in his high school days.
Which is why the next Pixar film's probably going to be Adventures on the Jungle Cruise.
Hey, you heard it here first.
another news break.
New from Disney's Pixar, The Jungle Cruise.
And before you guys get too bouncing off the walls here, let's wrap up this particular segment. For you Harry Potter fans out there, there's an awesome article on the Adventures by Daddy blog, and it's called Operacium, Universal Orlando's Wizarding World of Harry Potter, Diagon Alley Secrets Revealed.
Ooh.
So coming this summer to Universal Orlando, we are going to have Diagon Alley. I wanted to read to you a little snippet from this Adventures by Daddy article. Never before has a theme park created a guest experience like this. You climb aboard the Hogwarts Express in Hogsmeade and moments later arrive at King's Cross Station, where the wonders of London and Diagon Alley unfold before you. And it is all real.
This is what I love about the Wizarding World of Harry Potter. It's not just a ride here and there, but it's like you walked into the film.
It's immersive.
There's Hogwarts ahead of you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, all the buildings are snow-capped. There's the restaurant. There's the train.
Yes.
It just feels like you just walked into the movie.
It's almost as if Universal said, wow, Dave, Sarah, and Richard are coming in February. Why not wait until summer to open it?
Pretty much. But what they're going to have in Universal's Islands of Adventure, they're still going to have Hogwarts and Hogsmeade. And now in Universal Orlando Park, the other park, because there's two theme parks there, they're going to have Diagon Alley and London. The Hogwarts Express train is going to actually work and take you from one park to the other.
Well, this is like Disneyland and California Adventure, where you have two theme parks.
Uh-huh.
Wow.
So that's going to be like their version of the monorail.
Yeah, basically. Only I think they're going to have like scenes along the way, like as you're riding the train, and maybe stuff happens on the train. They didn't reveal all the secrets just yet.
So you know at some point the train is going to be attacked by Death Eaters and Dementors.
Oh my goodness, that would be cool.
That would be really cool.
That's just rumor, I guess, that we made up, but that would be awesome.
So is there a projected completion date for this?
Well, summer 2014. So I guess they've already been working on it. You're going to visit London and King's Cross Station, and then you're going to be able to enter Diagon Alley, where they have a bunch of shopping experiences, a lot of the shops that are well-known in Diagon Alley, and then you'll be able to take a detour to Nocturne Alley, where they have Borgin and Burks for all the people who like the dark side.
Now, at what point do you need to jump into a toilet to get from one place to the other? If they have that, I don't want to do that. I'm going to pass.
Hopefully not yet. But actually, the pinnacle of the Diagon Alley is going to be Gringotts, because they're going to have a new ride called Harry Potter and the Escape from Gringotts, which will place riders in the middle of an incredible adventure as they navigate their way through the perils of the Gringotts vaults.
Oh, that's going to be, that'll be like the Indiana Jones ride.
Mm-hmm. But you know they're going to charge a fortune to ride it.
And? Well, it's going to be a ride full of
they're
goblins.
They're going to be charging galleons.
You know what? I'm in.
So I'm so excited about this, and I know we're going to be there in February, and nothing is going to be ready yet. So, but we'll maybe we'll be able to see some construction.
So once again, that is coming this summer of 2014, 3 months after we leave.
A moment of silence for what we're missing.
Okay, Richard, it's time for the countdown.
All right, Dave, you get to join in on this one.
I can hardly wait.
All right, now, this is a countdown to Star Wars Celebration Anaheim. Dave, how far are you away from the Anaheim Convention Center?
Well, on the map, about half an inch.
So, as of the date that this podcast goes out, January 26th, how many more days until Star Wars Celebration Anaheim? Take a wild guess.
I'm looking at my fingers
if
and toes.
If you have been listening to the last couple of episodes.
Which you know I do regularly.
There you go.
I'm going to say seven.
Seven more days?
Yeah, because that's all I have on my hands.
Add 300 minus 35, divide by 2, plus 1138.
Wait, 443.
Whoa! You went to a private school?
Oh, that's the only place you're going to learn that kind of math.
That is some good math in there. I went to a public school, so I can say words like mathin'.
I learned how to read.
All right. Question number two in our Star Wars countdown. How many more days until Star Wars Episode 7?
It's got to be less than 700 now.
Almost.
I'm going to say 691.
Whoa!
I was just guessing.
You were just guessing that?
I was just totally guessing. Am I close?
That was right on the money. And he's not even sitting here in front of the computer.
No, I was just randomly picked that number out of the air using the Force.
And midichlorians.
You know, I wasn't going to say
cheated.
Anything.
You cheated. You had midichlorian help, didn't you?
Yeah, I was using the dark side a little.
Ugh.
I'm sorry, you know, but hey, you got to do what you got to do.
Well, that wraps up episode 15 of
Skywalking Through Neverland.
Join us next week as we air part two of our interview with Margaret Kerry.
Always remember, you can send us emails, share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com. And don't forget to connect with us on Twitter @SkywalkingPod and find us on Facebook, facebook.com/SkywalkingThroughNeverland. We've also added a member to our team on Facebook, Joey Pittman,
who's in Oregon right now covering Wizarding World. So it'll be great to hear Joey's report next week on what he found at the convention.
And also see some pictures which he's been posting this week.
Thank you very much, Joey. Good work out there. Now, we want to give a special shout out this week to Angela Doyle of On Gossamer Wings. Sarah, you own a pair of Angela's wings, don't you?
I do, and they are absolutely beautiful.
For those of you who have seen Jedi Tink, you'll know exactly what we're talking about. And we want to give her a special shout out because next week, we're going to feature a little bit where Angela made a special gift for Margaret Kerry. Can you connect the dots? What's a special surprise? What is it? What is it?
Oh, Dave, you get to say our outro line today.
And remember, never land on Alderaan. And as an extra bonus, for those of you watching on YouTube and skywalkingthroughneverland.com, it's time to watch Sam Shazam dancing with an Ewok hood.
Thank you for listening to Skywalking Through Neverland. We would love to hear what you thought of the show. Please send feedback and suggestions. You can email us at share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com. Please visit us at our website, skywalkingthroughneverland.com. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/skywalkingthroughneverland and on Twitter @skywalkingpod. All material submitted becomes the property of Skywalking Through Neverland and are subject for use on our show. You can help support Skywalking Through Neverland by posting about us on Facebook, Twitter, or just tell another fanboy or girl. We would also really appreciate a 5-star review on iTunes. A link to our iTunes page can be found on skywalkingthroughneverland.com. Skywalking Through Neverland was created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Segment producers are David Skale, Richard Woloski, Sarah Woloski, and Mark Agushowitz. Graphic design and website design by Sarah Woloski. Technical advisor is Peter Heitman. Skywalking Through Neverland is not affiliated with Lucasfilm Limited, Disneyland Resorts, or the Walt Disney Company. All names, sounds, and related items of Star Wars and Disney are registered, trademarked, and copyright Lucasfilm Limited and the Walt Disney Company and their respective trademark and copyright holders, all rights reserved. Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. All original content of this podcast is the intellectual property of Hey Hey Entertainment, copyright 2013, all rights reserved. No part of this show may be repurposed, reproduced, redistributed, or rebroadcasted without the written permission of Hey Hey Entertainment.
Sorry, all that had to be said.
Goodbye. Live long and prosper. Wait, sorry. May the force be with you.
And cut. That's a wrap.